I had the great privilege of being an identical twin, which I considered one of the greatest gifts I've ever had. You know, you always felt loved. It was like there was a mirror type of thing, and since I always admired her, it was sort of like admiring yourself. So it was very, very satisfying, and I think that was one of the things that made my childhood so happy. Also, my older sister was just 20 months older than we were, and so there were the three of us, and we used to have all sorts of groups called the Dick Dick Language Lemon People and the Blue Girls. And so when we were seven, my brother was born, and he was kind of an alien for a while. I guess he really felt that. But the three of us were very close with our mother, and she used to read to us. You know, we don't get in one big bed and read to us. She read us Heidi and all sorts of stuff like that. So it was, and to this day, my sister will be 74 this year, and we're all extremely close, and we finally did get close with my brother. So I always sort of adored my father, but he was a business executive eventually, and so, you know, he was gone a lot. And fathers at that time, for the most part, did not participate with the family raising children. We always, on our vacations where we went fishing, we always felt like we could get to know Dad a lot better. And one thing I did remember the other day was that the fishing plugs, he always had them talking to us. And I think that my tendency toward having inanimate things talk probably came from him. Both of my parents were quite playful, which was a great privilege too. Picking berries was absolutely a big summer ritual. In fact, we grew a lot of our food, particularly during the Second World War. They gave you big plots of land, and everybody had their own victory gardens. We grew and canned and preserved a huge amount of our food supply. And then Dad and my mother both went hunting, and so we would eat squirrel, rabbit, deer, and then scads of vegetables. We also then went berry picking at least once a year and nut hunting in the fall. So we would go along the highway and we picked up hazelnuts, black walnuts, some other kind of nut too. And then picking blackberries, even though they were you know, very sticky, and have huge buckets, and then we would make jelly out of them. And so down in the basement, I can remember we had huge shelves full of canned food. We would make applesauce, you know, 50 quarts of applesauce and tomatoes and everything. We spent a good part of the summer, which was very pleasing to us. I mean, you know, we all, the three of us would be working with Mom in the kitchen, and I remember our hands being very black from peeling apples all along. And I'm sure that sounds not like a pleasant thing for kids now, but it was very satisfying, and we felt like we were doing something with the family, and our relationship with our mother was very nice too. So it was always a good time when we were canning. Oh, a vacation for us was almost always going on fishing trips, because my dad just loved to fish. And so we would go up to a little cabin and rent it. I remember Mom always had to scrub it down before we moved in for a week. And they were always on lakes in Michigan, Wisconsin, Minnesota, and then eventually into Canada. But it was very limited to the natural world. Not that that's not good. We enjoyed it enormously. And like I say, we did get to know our dad better. They would tell stories. And I remember one year when my mother's father was 80 and he went with us. And then he would sit around the fireplace in the evening and tell us stories of how he grew up, which I wish I had recorded some of that or something, because that was a very interesting world. Because in many ways, the generation before us was more like us than the generation after us. because the ideas, certainly the ideas of what women did, but also men, I mean, you know, they just, it was not this expanded sense of possibilities at all. It was very limited, but it was very heavily family values, which in many ways I honor that and I'm glad we had that. There's just this little sense of loss or disappointment that there weren't the possibilities for us, Sarah Neil. And I find that even my own daughters cannot conceive of how differently we were brought up and conditioned. I remember talking to my older daughter before they got married, and she really couldn't understand how being programmed. We were brought up in Catholic schools, for one thing, which had very limited concepts of what women could be. How different or how difficult it was to reprogram yourself to this more expanded vision of what life could be, besides being ladylike and good. Mom had, as many people at that time did, had hopes of us moving up the social scale. She was brought up on a farm, and we were to go to college. She always emphasized being very ladylike, and since we were not real rough-hewn, you know, we had soft features and everything, we really did look like a lady, and I'm glad she can't see me now. We gave that up quite some time ago. We had music lessons and dance lessons. We had dance lessons. And at the college we went to, which was a Catholic college, we learned exactly how to sit like a lady, you know, just so much of your leg could be up so you didn't have any. Certainly, spreading your legs in any manner was enormously distasteful. And then we always were taught that even when you went shopping, to wear gloves and a hat. And we definitely passed as ladies at the time. The word lady, later, it certainly in my mind, became synonymous with being docile and conventional, and so it became quite an insult for me to be called a lady after a certain point. And that was one of the many things I rebelled against as far as who I was. I have been thinking about that partly because I have granddaughters now, and see the enormous choices women have now. And women no longer expect to just get married and have children. And we did go to college, which was not rare, but I mean, it certainly isn't as widespread as it is now. But the saying always was, well, if something happens to your husband, of course, divorce was not very popular. And when we chose what we were going to get into, the three choices was you could be a secretary if you didn't go to college. And then you could either be a teacher, mostly of grade school kids, or a nurse. And my older sister became a nurse, and Bobby and I became a teacher. And I did teach for a small amount, and I did kind of enjoy it, but it's certainly not the choice that I would have ever made now. My twin was very, very similar to me. We took turns, not consciously, of course, being the more outgoing one. I became much more emotionally expressive than she did. In fact, many of the pictures of our childhood, you know, she has a much more staid look on her face than I did. And I could erupt emotionally much, much more than she could. I had quite a temper. And of course, being angry was one thing you weren't allowed to do either. I mean, it was, you know, it was one of the sins to become angry. And she married, she actually met her husband at the same time that I did at the Catholic Newman Club at Ohio State. And I got married first. I had already had Chris by the time she got married the next August. So we shared the same wedding dress. And even though we've lived apart, you know, in different states and so forth, we have enormously helped the telephone companies grow. And to this day, we are extremely alike. When I went back to art school, she went back to horticulture school, because the natural world has always been one of our obsessions. And so she was making art with flowers and plants, and I was making art on paper and clay and so forth. But it's been an unbelievably close union with another human being. I think if we were to be interviewed, what we have valued in life would be very, very similar. We're both drawn to the mystical, the art. Beauty is an obsession with both of us. The thing that, when I talked to other artists that I went back to school with and so forth, most of them were not encouraged in art making at all. But our mother really encouraged us, you know, and where we didn't have very much money for art supplies or anything, and she got us wood carving tools, plaster cast, you know, so there were just huge amounts of stuff that we made. I remember one time making the Stations of the Cross and putting them around our room like they did in church. We were very adept at making doll clothes from the time we were, and of course all our dolls talked to us too. Actually, she's the only other 72-year-old woman that has a teddy bear that she keeps in constant contact with. And you know, emotionally, we're so in tune that it's nice to have somebody that understands you as much as. And probably this weekend, she's in Ohio. I've talked to her 5 or 6 times this week already. Dating was painful. Because we weren't very outgoing. You know, we were never real popular with the boys. And there was also, the boys seemed pretty immature and silly sometimes. But, you know, we got through it. There was that one summer, I must have been coming out of my shell or something. I had 4 boyfriends sort of simultaneously. That was kind of an interesting experience. Certainly, sex was never even considered. I mean, only the bad girls ever had sex, and you know, that was not part of dating at all. I don't think even among non-Catholics and stuff, it just was very seldom done. And you know, sex education and stuff was just, you know, I can remember that they at one point actually told us girls separately about having periods and so forth, but I mean, understanding the human body or what to expect or anything was completely non-existent. We were allowed to go out alone, but it seems to me we had a curfew and stuff, and well, go to school and church dances and affairs like that. And well, I remember going with one just prior to my husband, and after many months, he finally kissed me, quickly. I think that was the last time I saw him, too, so maybe I didn't do it right. Certainly, very little experience. When I met my husband, who I've now been married to for 50 years, he was quite different than I was, and remained so. But in many ways, that was a, you know, to even say it was a choice, I'm not sure. You know, you sort of fall in love, and I think my daughters and my granddaughters might have much more perspective about who they're marrying than I did at the time. But it worked out. It worked out rather well. It's been a chance for enormous growth for both Roy and I. 10 months after we got married, I had my first daughter, and 11 months later, I had my second daughter, and my husband was still in graduate school, which was an extreme amount to try to handle with somebody that had not had any more experience or practice. And of course, we were dirt poor, but I enjoyed it. I mean, I was very thrilled with the kids and enjoyed them enormously, played with them a lot. So, you know, it was only later as I awakened the new ideas and so forth that I began to realize. I was reading profusely at that time always very serious literature. So, you know, gradually I became discontent with just staying at home and skimping and saving. It was a very upsetting time, the transition to becoming who I am from how I was brought up. There was a great deal of personal struggle and guilt and trying new things. I remember when the kids were little, one of the acceptable things to do, most people did not go out without their husbands at all in the evening, but one of the few things was that they gave Tupperware parties, and I suddenly realized that I was only free to go to a Tupperware neighborhood party, and to this day I will not have a piece of Tupperware in my house, because that was such a terrible awareness. And eventually, one of the things which was a great source of growth for me was I joined a great books group, which I was in for over 20 years, where I met many people who were quite intellectually developed. And of course, I had all the pat answers for Catholicism and the truth of Catholicism. And we read the book, Great Book series. And eventually, I began to form my own ideas and became rather articulate in explaining them. So it really was a growth, enormous growth experience. And that eventually became the one night a month that I went out by myself. The church part, I have good and bad feelings about that. It was, of course, very limiting in the sense of controlling your thinking, which, of course, is what they were after. You know, they had very tight definitions of what goodness was, and what goodness turned out to be was following the rules and being submissive. We were often told that, you know, you shouldn't act too smart around the guys, that they wouldn't like it. Fortunately, we were kind of quiet children. On the other hand, being in Catholic schools did promote the sense of excellence and seeking things on a higher level, and also self-discipline, which turns out is a pretty good quality to have in your life, because you can do so many more things when you have some discipline and regulation. So, you know, it certainly wasn't all bad. Looking back, you know, I can see some cruelty, small-mindedness. But the Catholic Church had and has phenomenal rituals, and that certainly appealed to my artistic sense. And even today, a great deal of the art I am interested in making is of a spiritual nature. So it awakened my metaphysical nature, which was also very much a part of me. So good and bad, like most things. Well, when I was in my early 40s, I went back to college. We graduated, you know, in the usual manner from nice Catholic girls' school and all that. And during my 30s, I had taken up the ceramic arts, playing with real clay and so forth, got very involved in that and did shows and everything. Never made anything very practical, like bowls. And because Bobby and I were always very artistically inclined and made things continuously, most of our childhood was obsessively making things. And so it never occurred to me, you know, there was never any counseling or anything that anybody said, well, you could be an artist or something. We were brought up in a small town too, and so our connected to the world and world ideas was extremely limited. And of course, there wasn't anything like TV that could introduce you and widen your perspective of the possibilities. And so in some respects, I'm very happy to see women doing so many different things and very excited about the possibility for my granddaughters. And my daughters have had very interesting lives. But there is some little bit of sadness that, even though I've had a wonderful life, that those choices weren't there for us.